Hey, I have an idea. Let's talk about batteries. It's been a while since I've answered questions from the videos, right? So this time around, let's see if we can answer one from last video. Blaze Low says, how could we make it have constant 400 amp output? Adding two BMSs? If so, would you have to split the cell bank so it's 16 cells per BMS? If I'm trying to use this for high power car audio. Okay, he's talking about the last video where we built a 32 cell headway battery that can put out tons and tons of power. I mean, 1000 amp, whatever. Each one of those can do on short circuit like 300 amp, and there's 8 in parallel, right? So you do the math there. It's a lot of amps. Now, of course, the problem is that I always suggest you use a BMS, right? So that your cell stays safe. And there are no BMSs out there really that can handle, you know, that much amperage, like over 200, 300 amps. They're hard to get. They're big. They're super expensive. And so he's asking, how do we do that? The bus bar plates that just came in, they can handle 500 amp continuous, no problem. 1000 amp peaks. But how do you get that much power off of a pack if there is no BMS that can handle that? So really what I suggest in this case is to do what we've been doing for a long time in DIY electric cars. And in electric cars, you don't use a BMS that is based off of MOSFETs, right? And the reason is because, well, it's a switch. A BMS is essentially a big switch that will turn on and turn off power to or from your battery, right? Depending on a certain conditions that need to be met. And when you're talking about a car size switch, then you're talking about big expensive piece of equipment. We have a switch, a MOSFET based switch is actually a central part of an electric vehicle, right? And it's one of the most expensive parts. That explains the reason why we're not using a MOSFET based BMS, right? So it would be another giant controller that is just as much as the main controller, would double the price or the cost of an electric vehicle system, right? So what they do is they use contactors, right? Something similar to this guy right here. This is a switch, a relay, right? And it's a mechanical version one. And they look like this. I've done videos about them. I actually did a video a long time ago where I paralleled two of those because I was having trouble with my system that was welding shut or overheating mine. And so, you know, I doubled up like that and it's been working. So the question is, can we do that in smaller systems sort of like this so that you can have a battery system that is BMS and yet still can output, you know, over 500 amps. So I just build a little setup here to show you how you can do it. Okay, so here's my battery system. This is what we built in the last few videos, right? And here are the plates that we got to put this battery together. Now that's a 12 volt battery. Here's the BMS. Now that is all these cables go connected. You know, there's four, and it seems like there's more of them because I also have the cables connected for this guy, which is, you know, just gonna show us what the battery is doing. This is a switch. It's a smart switch, kind of smart, because it only turns on when the voltage of these four groups of batteries are within a safe range. So between 2.5 volts to 3.6 volts, right? So that's the healthy part of the voltage for this chemistry, light lithium iron phosphate. And so when those conditions are met, and this guy knows because of these little cables here, then this switch turns on, right? The problem is, of course, that, well, this is only rated 100 amps. And if you want more than that, then they start, like I said, start getting costly. So what you do is you use this switch to turn on a relay switch. And these are automotive switches. They come in all kinds of different configurations, you know, 500 amps, you know, almost 1000 amps they come. And so this switch, when this thing is on, it turns on, it applies power to this guy and it turns it on, right? And then that turns on this guy, and this is our load here, and then even this. So
The only caveat here is that this kind of is power hungry, and so this really works good for loads that are gonna be on intermittent times, right? So it's like power walls and stuff that are always supposed to be on either charging or discharging. This wouldn't be the best option because this is kind of like it's using a lot of power, right? And so like if you think about it for audio systems or stuff that it's only gonna be on for short amount of times, but they require a lot of power, then these are great. If you think about it, cars are sort of like this, right? They're usually not on more than a couple hours at a time, and the rest of the time they're off. And then when they're off, any electric vehicle, their battery is disconnected from the main system through these guys. They're called contactors, right? But they're just big mechanical relays. So this is the setup, now let's run it.
All right, there it is. That is the last frame that the BMS had power, right? It worked. The BMS turned off its MOSFETs, which cut the circuit, and then the mechanical relay shut off, right? And so analyzing this last frame here, it tells us something very important. You see that 1L here on this one little device, that means the cell group number one was at 2.1 volts, right? And on this frame. And the very next frame, it went down to 2 volts. And that is where the cutoff is for the BMS. So any of the cells, any of the 4 cell groups reaches 2 volts, then it turns itself off. And that's exactly what happened here. So that's how it works. And for charging is the exact same thing. The upper limit of this BMS, I don't really know. It's for 3.6, 3.7, 3.8. I don't really know where it's at, but it should be somewhere up there. If any of the group cells were to hit that, then the BMS turns itself off, turning off the relay that is connected to the output of that, right? And so this is one way that you can have one of these batteries have a really high output with a small BMS. This BMS was really cheap. It's somewhere around $12, I believe, down on Amazon. We used this on another build and we successfully paralleled it, right? But this BMS, it's actually kind of overkill at 100 amps. You could get a smaller 4S BMS that gives enough power just to turn on the mechanical contactor, right? And so, yeah, you can find those on Amazon. You can find those on AliExpress and all the other places online where you can buy this sort of stuff, right? There are all kinds of different types of BMSs. There are BMSs that have a thermistor in there so you can check temperature. There's some that connect to through Bluetooth so it tells you exactly the state of the battery. Then there's all kinds of fancy ones, right? And so there's more than one way to do this thing here, but that is one. This is a very effective way to have a very high output battery without the use of a very expensive high power BMS. All right, I hope this video helped you. I want to thank you for watching this video, for all your support, and see you guys on the next.
When it failed, what I thought the problem was that I had failed to maybe tighten the 2 nuts that connect the cables onto here tight enough, and then that created extra heat, and that made it fail. So that was my theory of why the first contactor failed.
Make sure you hold it with some pliers, because it's gonna get hot.
All right, guys, this has been a quick tip on how to use 2 small contactors to do the job of 1 big one. Now we go back.